Hey, everybody, thank you for watching our YouTube channel. I believe this message is going to be a powerful blessing in your life, and I'll be right back at the conclusion to pray for you. I want you to take your Bibles this morning. We're going to continue on kingdom business. That's what we've been focusing on. And the title of this morning is Be Fruitful and Multiply. In the book of Genesis, chapter 1, in verse 27, he says, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. And then in chapter 9, in verse 1, and God blessed Noah and his sons and said, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And then if you go with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 15, and I read from verse 1, Jesus said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And even branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth, that he may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word that I've spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. I'm the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. Everybody say, much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and withered. And men gather them and cast them into a fire, and they are burned. But I love this verse. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, that means if you live in me and my words live in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done for you. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, so shall you be my disciples. It is impossible to call yourself a follower of Jesus and have no fruit from your life. If you travel around the world like we've had the privilege of traveling, 53 nations, going to churches, and one of the craziest things is to meet people that you saw 10 years ago, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, and they still have no fruit from their life whatsoever. And then you ask them the question, you know, what's going on? And they always blame everybody else. The devil's attacking me. These people have been mean to me. These people hurt me. These people did not help me. And those are all the excuses that are used. But I want you to know that when you take everything out of the equation, and you realize that there's nobody to blame, that when you understand that you have power over the enemy, that the devil can't mess with you anymore, that you have authority over him and you have dominion over him, and that, yes, people can hurt you, but you have to make the choice not to be hurt. Who thinks that I've had many opportunities to be totally, extremely hurt? I shouldn't even be in the ministry today. But I just made a decision. You know, man did not call me. God called me. And ultimately, I have to stand before the Lord and give an account of my life on that day. And as long as the Bible says, if your heart doesn't condemn you, then you have confidence before God. So then it does not really matter what anybody says about you, what they think about you. Everybody is entitled to their own opinion. And as we always say around the river, opinions are like armpits. Everybody has them, and some of them stink. So I want to say this, please forgive me if I don't run around based on your opinion of me, whether it be good or bad, because I already have received the opinion from heaven concerning my heavenly Father and concerning Jesus of what his opinion is of me, and I've been accepted. I've been made to be into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you say amen? And all I'm concerned about is what heaven has to say. And if heaven says go, then I'm going. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I mean, you're going to have people hurt you. You're going to have people do things. But you can't run around and walk in fear. Some people are like a cactus. All prickly. You can't get near them. They're afraid they're going to get hurt. Oh, I've been abused. People took advantage of me. You know, I'm here to be taken advantage of. You want to take advantage, go right on ahead. I'll give you a chance once, twice, maybe even three times, you know. Amen. But you can't take what the Lord has given to me, because what the Lord has given to me is eternal. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. People will try to take your reputation, but your reputation is not based on what they think of you. Your reputation is based on what God thinks of you. And I have received heaven's mandate along with you that we are to be fruitful and to multiply. Because at the end of the day, we're going to stand before the Lord, give an account of our life, of what we have done here on the earth. And what am I going to say? Well, Lord, I would have done it, but you know what they did? They blocked me over here. If I get blocked over here, I go over there. Amen. If they stop me over there, then I go around. I go over, I go under, I go around, or I go through. Hallelujah. Everybody say over, under, around, or through. David said, I can run through a troop and leap over a wall. But bless God, if I need to, I'll run through the wall and leap over the troop. I mean, whatever it takes. Why? Because we've received the mandate, be fruitful, multiply. And I want my life to be multiplied for the kingdom. So many people have been stopped from being fruitful based on other people's opinions. You almost have to come to a place where you're totally immune to what anybody says. When I was a little kid going to school, you know, they pick on you. They always pick on kids, especially the 2 years older, the kids in the next grade, they bully the younger kids, you know. And I go back crying to my mother, you know, they said this about me. My mother said, well, sticks and stones can break your bones, but names can never hurt you. And so that was a little thing that we got going. People would call your name. Sticks and stones will break my bones, but names can never hurt me. You know, that's a little thing that you just kept. What can a name do? It can't really hurt you, especially when you know that you've already been accepted. Amen. Who's ever been called something? Who has been called things that are not really nice to be called? Come on, wave your hand at me. You can't live off of that. Call me fruitful. They can say what they like, but we're going to produce fruit. They can say what they like, but we're going to multiply. And you have to become single-minded concerning that. Because Jesus said, herein is my Father glorified, when you bear much fruit. And when you bear fruit, you prove yourself to be his disciple. So you can't call yourself a disciple if you have no fruit. Say this after me. I am a disciple of the Lord, and I prove it because I'm a fruit producer. That's the mandate given to me by Jesus. He's looking for fruit. Colossians 1 and 10, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. When people look at you where you are now and they want to criticize where you are now, you say, hey, where I am now is not where I'm going to stay. You watch this. Just give me 3 years. Just give me the next 3 years. You watch. You'll see. I'm growing. Amen. We adjusting. We changing. We repairing. We studying. We familiarizing ourselves. We're not just sitting watching television reruns of Bonanza. We're educating ourselves. We're learning. And you hang around failures, you become a failure. You hang around critical people, you become a critical person. You hang around a lazy person, you become a lazy person. You hang around a stupid person, you become a stupid person. You hang around an idiot, you become an idiot. You hang around, if it's a lady, if you hang around a woman that hates men, then you're gonna hate men. If you're a man and you hang around other men that hate women, you're gonna hate women. You hang around people that have a successful marriage, you'll have a successful marriage. You hang around people that hate kids, and my kids will just grow up to be a bum, be just like their father. Your kids will grow up to be a bum just like their father. But you hang around people that have successful children, you're gonna have successful children. It's all in your identity. Where are you getting your identity from? And we have to get our identity out of the new creature in Christ Jesus, not out of the old creature that once you get born again is dead and buried. Don't identify with your past. I was talking to one of our staff just before the service, and I said to the young lady, I said, because we're getting testimonies now for the 1 hour television special that we're gonna start airing in the month of August. And when I read the report on a testimony, I didn't even know these things. I said, wow. I said, you actually are a walking miracle. I mean, your husband, your children, your everything. She started crying. She said, yes, the Lord's been good to me. She said, I don't really even think about the past, because she said, it doesn't seem like it was me, you know, because, but she has no identity in that past person, even though she's now gonna tell her testimony. So how many people that you know today, they love God, but their identity is still in the way they were 10, 15, 20 years ago before Jesus saved them? You have to take on the new identity in Christ. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. When you're a righteous person, when you pray, then your prayers avail much. Your prayers make mighty power available. Hallelujah. You're not the one running around, always pray for me. We are to pray for one another, but you're not running around, please pray for me. You're the one praying for other people. Your life becomes an oasis. You're not having to be helped up every day. Oh, please pray for me. I'm just struggling, I'm going through it. You might be going through all of the struggles and the attack of a normal individual, and yet you are focused on helping others and meeting the needs of others. And your sustenance and your watering comes from when you water others, because he who waters, he himself shall also be watered. So I don't wake up in the morning, no matter what the needs are, no matter what the storm is coming against me, I don't wake up focusing on the storm. Oh my God, what are we gonna do? I immediately look out, see other people are in worse storms than I am, and we focus on those, and we go out of way to meet the needs of others. And when we look again, somehow the Lord brought us through the other side. Can you say amen? Amen. I mean, not that we're going through anything right now, you know, in any attack or whatever, but there have been Sundays when we've been going through all hell and none of you would have known it, because I didn't come out here. I came out here in the victory, and then the Lord brought us through it. Amen. Can you say amen? Amen? Imagine if I walked out here on Sunday depressed. Imagine if I came out, well, church, it's been a hard day's night and I've been working like a dog. And God leads some through the fire, some through the flood, and we all end up in the mud. And y'all pray for me, I don't know how we're gonna make it. Really? The Bible says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, and the Lord delivers us out of them. So there might be battles out there, but once you have the peace in here, the battle's not gonna be reflected on your face. The peace of God will be reflected on your face. Peace in the time of trouble. Peace in the midst of the storm. Peace when there's upheaval. Peace when the battle's raging. In actual fact, in the greatest battle, you'll be asleep at the back of the boat with Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. I feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost here. Don't look at yourself the way you are now. Well, the way you are now is not the way you're going to be. I don't ever look at people where they are now. I look at them where they're going to be. In the natural, you can't get anywhere. But in God, in Christ, hallelujah, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You are more than a conqueror. Hallelujah. Now, we have to look at what we have in our hands. Every time we've had a need in the ministry, the Lord's always said to me, what do you have in your hand? You know, that's the last place that many people go look at, because they don't even consider that they might have in their hand the very thing that will bring about the solution. And every time we had a need, we always had it somewhere in our hands. Sometimes it was in the warehouse. Sometimes it was we looking for something, you know. My God. And our pastors will tell you, there'd be times we're in a pastor's meeting when they were telling me about Studio B, how run down it was. We didn't have the cash to go and renovate it. And I stood up in my office. I said, bless God. Get everything, order that, get the carpet. And we didn't have the money. I just spoke it out. And within a matter of a few days, we found a piece of equipment in the warehouse. We sold it and we paid for everything. So what do you have in your hand? Many times when it comes to business, many times when it comes to being a success in life, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, because anybody could come in here on Sunday and look like an angel. But then Monday, it's a different story. So I'm not looking for Sunday morning Christians. I want Monday morning Christians. I want believers being fruitful on a Tuesday, being fruitful on a Wednesday. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Remember this. It's impossible to have the anointing and be in lack. Who thinks that if you have a problem and Jesus comes to your house, everything's going to change? Wave your hand at me. Well, he's come to your house. And people can go through their life not even acknowledging that Jesus has come to their house. And by the way, happy birthday, son. It was his birthday on Friday. Hallelujah. People can go through life and not even acknowledge that Jesus has come to their house. They're looking everywhere else. Oh, if only that person, I need to get with somebody, they can give me a leg up. If I could get the connection with that individual. What do you have in your hand? What do you have in your hand? Go back to the drawing board. Everyone has something in their hand, and that is called a talent. And that talent is that which needs to be multiplied. The three young ladies that we blessed with talents, now they have something in their hand that they can take and multiply. Somebody said, well, nobody don't bless me with no talent, my God. Well, but the fact is that you'll be surprised that you probably already have it in your hand. So don't go looking other places when it's already there. Why? Because God's already put it there. And that's the thing that you must multiply. I can't multiply what I don't have, but I can surely multiply what God's given to me. Amen. And the talent, when it comes to a talent, it comes easy. When it comes to talent, it's not difficult. Like he has a talent to write computer code, 8 computer languages and stuff. He reads those big computer books with stuff I don't even know what it is, and he reads them like they're just a newspaper. That's his gift. Don't ask me to do that. I'd blow the computer up. I wouldn't even know what was going on. And he would do that at the age of 14. I mean, he knew how to record the keystrokes to get into the school lessons to even get the test results. And we don't understand how he's getting A's, but he knew exactly. No. He had a program on there that recorded every key press from my wife come in and put the code in there. She leaves, he come in there. We have no clue. Yeah. He was just using his talent. You know. Which I didn't even know you could do that. I didn't even know that you could put something on your computer that would even record the keystrokes when people were on there, that you could see what they typed. He knew that. We didn't know that. No, he wasn't commended for it. He didn't. He received ministry for that. I mean, when you're 14 years old and you're able to do that, then you think, what if he hacked a major government site? I mean, the next thing, we're sitting around having a barbecue, Black Hawk helicopters on the roof, you know. People come, take my kid away. What happened? No, your son hacked the FBI site and whatever. But people, anyway, sorry, didn't mean to bring that up. But talents are things that can either be used in the wrong way or can be used in the right way. You take Elvis Presley. Here's a classic example. Elvis actually went to try out for a gospel group and got turned down because the other singers felt like he couldn't really sing. What idiots. Who wants to even go on record that you turned down Elvis Presley? Caleb and Kirsten were preaching in Memphis last Sunday, and on Monday they went to Graceland, to Elvis's house, and my son-in-law called me and said, Dad, I never knew this about Elvis. He said, you know, the most records ever sold before Elvis was the Beatles. They sold 600 million records. Elvis sold 1 billion records. And even in the 60s, he had his own airplane with bathroom on and toilet on, and he was way ahead of everybody. And there's a whole wall in his house dedicated just to what he was giving away. He would give away equivalent of $1,000 a day, which today would be about $13,000, paid off houses, cars, blessing charities, churches, all over the place. There's no telling how many millions that he sowed. And that he would come from each of his night concerts and he would spend in the back singing all gospel hymns. Probably one of the greatest gospel singers of all times. Probably sold more gospel records than anybody. How great thou art, then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. And that was a man that had a talent that was supposed to be used for the kingdom of God, but the kingdom of God rejected him. And so he got hurt. The talent was still used. Do you understand what I'm saying? And he did love Jesus. He might not have, you know, lived the way that we think. Somebody said, do you think Elvis is in heaven? Of all the people that are out there, I believe Elvis is in heaven right now going, thank you very much. I do believe he made it. No, because he did love Jesus. You know, maybe he didn't like religion or the church or what they had done to him, but he did love Jesus. He wanted to sing gospel more than anything else. Now, there's other stars and whatever. I don't believe they made it to heaven. And I might be shocked when I get there. And I think we all be shocked they get there. Some people might find out there are people they thought would never make it. And then some people that even thought that the other people would make it didn't make it themselves, you know. So I think it's going to be real shocking on that day. And I'm not saying just because a superstar dies, we all say rest in peace, because many of them don't rest in peace. They go to a lost eternity, they burn in hell, and that's the sad thing of it. That's the sad reality of it. The very sad reality. that not everybody's going to make it into the kingdom of heaven. Broad is the way that leads to destruction. Many there be that find it. Narrow is the way that leads to life eternal. Narrow is the way constricted by pressure. And few there be that find it. So it's not just, you know, hey, I go to church and I said the prayer. It's from your life, the fruit of that reality of that new creation is being made manifest. And I believe that one of the fruits that will be made manifest from your life will be holiness, will be holy living. We don't sing hallelujah on Sunday and cuss like a sailor on a Monday. We don't lift our hand on Sunday morning and flip people the bird on a Tuesday. We don't come drink the new wine of heaven and then find ourselves in a bar somewhere. And I know people say, well, you're just religious. No, I'm not. I've lost too many people, good people, to alcohol, to even sanction even a drink. You can call me whatever you want to, but I don't need it. We don't need it. Our family don't need it. We don't miss anything. We don't miss one thing. Amen. Hallelujah. Fruit. Everybody say fruit. We're not talking about bananas and papayas and guavas and lychees and grapes. Fruit. 12 months from now, you should be in a whole different place than you are right now. You should not be in the same place. You should have grown. People, you should be able to look and track the growth. Say, look, 12 months ago I was here, look where I am now. Come on, and I can prove it to you. How many can say that 12 months ago to now, you're in a whole different place than you were 12 months ago? So what is that? That's fruit. We are stewards of what we've been given. We have it in our hands. We'll give an account of what we do with it. We should not bury it, and if we don't use it, we're going to lose it. Like there's certain people that are phenomenal musicians, can play instruments, but you never hear them play. Phenomenal, can play saxophone, play piano, phenomenal musicians. I mean, I don't know who they would be. I mean, I don't single anybody out. But there are people that are phenomenal in music, in instrument, you know, the saxophone, keyboards, whatever. Listen, we need to take our talents and use them. No, I mean, the same goes for me. I mean, the same goes to me. I play guitar, lead worship, you know. I mean, you know, one of the things I do is lead worship. I don't do that anymore. I've heard from some of the top worship leaders that told me that they listened to the worship when I used to lead it, and they wonder why I don't do more worship. And these are the top worship leaders in America. And they wonder why I don't do more worship. So, you know, I understand that. I mean, I'm not just picking on him. I'm picking on me. I'm picking on all of us. If we have talents and we are not using them for the kingdom of God, then we should be rebuked. So we take the rebuke. Rebuke received. Amen. So I want that piano out. The piano is behind the thing there. I want that piano out, and I want you on it. I want that saxophone on a stand there. I mean, you don't have to play every song, but play some song. Why we got a piano behind the veil there? Who's playing it? Where's the B3? We need a B3 player. My God, is there no B3 player in the house? We got these instruments. All right, I'll stop meddling now and just leave it alone. No, it's back here. Along with a whole bunch of stands. Look at this. Here it is back here. Come here, sit down, quickly. Just play. Lord, my God. When I, in awesome wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Now, if there's other people sitting with talents that are not being used, that's all I'm saying. You can close up that thing. Are you okay there, Pastor Derek? Where are you? No, I just picked on one thing. But I mean, I'm telling you right now that what we have in our hands. Oh, no, God, no. Mom, I've already dealt with it. Mom, I've already dealt with it. No, I was just doing that to prove a point. Our talents must be used for the extension of the kingdom of God. Amen. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 17. God has given you an anointing to create wealth. The Bible says, verse 17, thou saying thine heart and my might, my power and the might of my hand hath gotten me this wealth. But thou shalt earnestly remember the Lord thy God. It is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant which he swore to thy fathers as it is to this day. You look at people in the church, and one of the things they deal with is poverty. But they don't realize that they've been redeemed from poverty. Galatians 3 and verse 13 says, Christ has redeemed you from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. And verse 29 says, and if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. The curse of the law was threefold. It was spiritual death, which is separation from God. It was sickness and disease, and it was poverty and lack. For separation from God, he joined us back to him through Jesus Christ. And we've been united together with him. In Christ, in him we live and move and have our being. And then for sickness and disease, he bore our sicknesses and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. And then for lack, he has given us provision. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not lack. I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd to shield, guide me. He'll lead me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. So you are redeemed from poverty. Redeemed from poverty. Poverty is not a sign of spirituality, the same way riches are not a sign of spirituality. Because you can have the whole world and lose your soul. But when you have Jesus on the inside of you, then you are already one of the richest people on the face of the earth. When Jesus lives on the inside of you, you are richer than Bill Gates. You are richer than Warren Buffett. Because at the end of their life, without Jesus, they will go to a lost eternity. But at the end of your life, you'll go to be with Jesus. And he said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. He's preparing a place for you now. Somebody said, well, let's go home. No, it's not time yet. Somebody said, well, I'm just so tired of living on this earth. My God, I just wish Jesus would come and take me home. Brother Rodney, just pray, Pastor. Pray that Jesus come and take me home. You just want to be put out of your misery. Why don't you let the greater one rise up on the inside of you? Blessed is the man who walking through the valley of Baca and maketh a well. Blessed is the man that comes through the places where death and destruction are. And wherever they go, oases spring up. Why? Because he lives on the inside of you. It don't matter where you go. It don't matter where they send you. When you walk into the place, the very atmosphere is going to change because he lives on the inside of you. When you have this revelation, they can take you, they can put you in one of the worst places on the planet. 3 years later from now, they come back and they find an oasis has sprung up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say this, I'm redeemed from poverty. So Jesus became everything we were to make us everything he is. Somebody said, where do you get this from? I read the fine print in the document. In 2 Corinthians 8 and 9, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was so very rich, yet for your sakes he became so very poor, that you through his poverty might become rich. You can't get any poorer than leaving the glory of heaven to come and take on human flesh and to be born in a manger. He wasn't born in the Hilton that was taken up with a preacher's conference. He was born in a manger. He became so very poor that you, through his poverty, might become rich. The word there in the Greek means to be well taken care of in the affairs of life. Hallelujah. Proverbs 13:22, a good man leaveth an inheritance to his children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the righteous, for the just. The wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. The problem is the just are not even just. Now go to Luke 19. We're going to begin to wrap it up here with this Luke 19. And verse 13. He called his 10 servants and delivered them 10 pounds and said, occupy till I come. Go back to Luke 12 now. Luke 12 and verse 15. And he said unto them, take heed and beware of covetousness. Now, how many understand what covetousness is? In its simplest form, covetousness is when you desire what somebody else has. God was very plain when he said, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, your neighbor's ass, his car, his donkey. That's what the Bible said. I'm not making that up. You know, I come from Africa where an ass is really an ass. It's a donkey. Yeah, in America, it's something else. It is. I mean, you say, you know, anyway. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's ass. Don't covet his car, his house. It's very much people see what other people have, and I want that. That's covetousness. So a lot of times businesses are motivated through greed. They dangle the car to show you you can get this. So people really are working because of covetousness. Some people work because of fear. Fear of failure, fear of poverty, want to make money, want to get themselves out of that. We should not, you and I should never be operating driven by a spirit of covetousness or greed or fear. We should be operating out of generosity and faith. Can you say amen? So he said here, for a man's life consists not of the abundance of the things which he possesses. For he spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentiful. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Because I have no more room to bestow my fruits. You can see people, they get wealthy, and then they build their big house or do whatever. And then they say, I've got no more room. And then said, this I'll do. I'll pull down my barns, build a greater. And there I'll bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I'll say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thy ease, eat, drink, and be merry. And you watch it happen towards the age of retirement where people, you know, have worked all, they got everything. Now they're going to build this whole thing and retire. But then they die. They retire within a year. They're dead. So they worked for 40 years for this moment. And then suddenly it's gone. Futility of futilities. He said here, God said, thou fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then who shall these things be which you have provided? So in other words, you have all that house, you have all those cars, you have all those everything. And then you die. And then who's going to get that? Well, if you know anything about the government, they're going to take most of it. You might get protection for $3.5 million for you, $3.5 million for your wife, that's $7 million, and then they're going to suck the rest out of you. And then the kids are going to have to pay inheritance tax. And so basically, you're just earning and working for the government. You're part of the slave system of America. Now, I won't get into that right now because Americans don't like to think that they are in slavery, but they really are in slavery. So he says, so is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. So what does that mean? It doesn't mean that you can't get blessed and that God can't increase you. But if you're not laying up treasure in heaven and you're not rich before God, you might be rich on the earth, but when you get to heaven, you have nothing. You're saved, but you have nothing to show for your life on the earth, which is a terrible thing if you think about it. He said unto his disciples, therefore I say, take no thought for your life. What will you eat? For your body, what you put on, is the life more than meat, and the body more than raiment. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have storehouse nor barn, and God feedeth them. How much more are you better than fowls, than a bird? And which of you by taking thought can add to his stature one cubit? If ye then be not able to do that which is least, why take ye thought for the rest? And you can see it. The wealthy right now are planning to do everything. I think it was Disney had himself frozen, called cryogenics, hoping that they can bring him back to life 100 years from now. But you can't pull a person's spirit out of hell. You can raise their body, but it'll probably be a demon that lives in the side of them. You can't bring their spirit back. Even if you bring their body back, you can't bring their spirit back. It's appointed and the man wants to die, and after that, the judgment. Next year, there's a man, a multimillionaire, out of Russia that is going to China to have the first head transplant. He's totally paralyzed, and they're getting a body for him, and the doctors are going to perform the surgery, chop his head off his old body, put it on a new body. And so you can imagine, if they get that right, there are going to be a lot of bodies that are going to disappear and other heads are going to end up on those bodies because they want to extend their life. You'll have somebody running around in a 30-year-old body and their head's like 120 years old. No, you laugh. That's what they want to do. And in some cases, they're trying to even now merge with machines. You put all your consciousness into a machine. The stuff that you see in sci-fi movies is actually becoming a reality because people want to live forever and they want to live without God. You can't live without God forever. He said, if you're not able to do the thing which is least, why take your thought for the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They toil not, neither spin. And yet I tell you that Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If God so clothed the grass which is today and tomorrow is cast in the oven, how much more will he not clothe you, or you of little faith? And seek not ye what you shall eat or what you shall drink, neither be of doubtless mind. For all these things do the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knoweth that you have need of all these things. But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock. For it is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. If he'll give you the kingdom, he'll give you a job. If he'll give you the kingdom, he'll give you your own business. If he'll give you the kingdom, he'll give you your own company. If he'll give you the kingdom, he will multiply you. When Pastor McCurdy wrote that song, when the Spirit of the Lord moved on my heart, I'll dance like David Dawns. He didn't know that thing would go around the world. And a lot of people think it's written like an Israeli, like a Hebrew, when the Spirit of the Lord, and they do like a Hebrew dance. He's an African-American. It's got nothing to do with Hebrew. But people didn't know that. And what was it, Holyfield, when he came into fight, then they played that song. And it went out on Showtime, or one of those things that aired. His song was sung around the world. Talents are taken to be multiplied. You know, where were we the other day? In some foreign country, they were singing your song. They were singing it. I think it was in Indian, in one of the Indian languages they were singing it. You didn't know that. But there's a whole bunch of Indians singing. When the Spirit of the Lord moved on my heart. He says here, sell that you have, give alms, provide yourself bags which wax not old, a treasure in heaven that faileth not, with no thief approaches, neither moth corrupteth. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Let your loins be girded about and your lights burning. That's what you have to be here at the river. This is not a religious institution. And you yourselves, like unto men that wait for the Lord, when will he return from the wedding? And when he cometh and he knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. Behold, are those servants whom the Lord, when he comes, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you, they shall gird himself and make them sit down to meat, and will come forth and serve them. And if he shall come in the second watch, or come in the third watch, and find them so blessed are those servants. And this know, that if the goodman of the house had known in what hour the thief would have come, he would have watched and would not suffered his house to be broken through. But ye therefore be ready also, for the Son of Man cometh an hour when ye think not. So what I want to say, because we believe in God, that God's going to raise up 100 multimillionaires in the house, different businesses for the purpose of funding the end time harvest, entrepreneurs, business owners. God will give you creative ideas, witty inventions. But please do not ever be covetous. Don't look at what other people have and lust after that. Be happy with other people's blessings. Amen. Can you say amen? Amen? Rejoice when you see others blessed. And you don't want what they have, because you couldn't handle what they have. You can handle what you have. Amen? Amen. Some said, well, I just love if somebody gave me a Rolls Royce. You couldn't even keep the thing up. You couldn't even have it serviced. The first service it went in, you'd be whining like a stuck pig. So be happy with your Camry. I'm serious. Oh, I wish I'd have me a Ferrari for the first month. For the first month, and then something go wrong with the Ferrari, and you send it in for a quote, they come back, $17,000. What? My God! Well, it's a $400,000 Ferrari. What did you think you were buying? So don't ever covet what other people have, because God gives them the grace to handle what they have, and God gives you the grace to handle what you have. Can you say amen? A person's life is not defined by their possessions. So don't run around, you know, thinking because you have a great collection, look at all my possessions, these, you know. And stuff comes and stuff goes. You know, if I don't use things, I give it away. We had two horses. How many know I had two horses? Actually, I had one. And then I had two. They gave one away, and they were going to get her pregnant and send me back the baby. And then she died, you know, when she was pregnant. So I'm down to one horse. Then I got given another horse. So I got two horses. But, you know, I'm not hardly around, didn't get to ride. So somebody said, do you know where I can get a horse? I said, yeah, I got a horse for you. So I blessed them with a horse. And then somebody else wanted a horse, so I blessed them with a horse. So last week, I'm walking around with my granddaughter, Ellie. She's 7 now. And she said, Pop-Pops, I'm coming to the house. I'm going to ride the horse. I said, sweetheart, we don't have any horses now. I gave them away. What? You gave away the horses? What am I going to ride? It was like the end of the world. Like, how could you? How could you even give away the horse? I said, baby, don't worry. I'll believe God. We'll get another horse. Friday night, I'm in a meeting in Columbus, Georgia. A pastor who actually lives here and lives there and whatever. And great church and what he said to my wife something about a horse. Well, she didn't bite, you know, because we got cows and they're about to have babies. And so he said, I tried to give your wife a horse. She didn't want it. I said, oh, yeah, a horse? You got a horse you want to give me? Yeah, she's a five-year-old filly. Her name is Missy, and she's a quarter horse, and she works with cows. I said, I'll take her, thank you. So I called Ellie, FaceTime, and said, baby, you want to know what happened? I said, there's a horse coming for you to ride, baby. Oh, pop-ups, I knew that, you know. So. So, you know, let me tell you. I mean, I promise you, when you don't even look for these things, they come to you.
That's right. Amen.
They come to you. Now, if she doesn't ride it, I'll give that one away. You know, because we don't sit with stuff we don't use. The cows get milked. We make cheese. We make butter, yogurt, all that kind of stuff. So we use the cows. If we have a bull, then we've got two babies going to be born. If one's a bull, I'm going to get rid of it because you can't really do anything with the bull. And I don't eat what I name. So, you know, I'm not going to call it anything. I won't just, it'll just be bull A. Huh? Name the bull dinner. No, because it'll still come to you when you say, dinner, dinner, then it'll come to you. Then I'll feel bad about it. So no. No, because we eat chickens. We don't name the chickens. We don't name one chicken. We don't crack an egg open, put it in the frying pan and go, Harry, is that you? All right, say this after me. I must not be covetous. My life is not determined by my possessions. I'm rich towards God. And I'm not going to be anxious about what I'm going to eat, what I'm going to wear, what I'm going to drink. Because my life is more than food. My body is more than clothing. I'm seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things are being added to me. And I'm living ready because in an hour that I don't expect, he's coming. And when he comes, then I'm going to have to give an account of my life. You look at people, they say the Lord's delayed, he's coming, and they're just in bed with the world. Well, I'm telling you, he hasn't delayed. He's coming. He is coming very soon. And I'm not going to go hide in a mountain somewhere waiting for him to come. We're here to occupy till he comes. I'm not a person motivated by fear, even though I know everything's going on the planet. I do not live one moment in fear. I live my day in faith. Can you say amen? Amen. Faith doesn't deny the facts, but looks to the greater facts of the Word of God. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. And we are here to take territory. To take territory. Now, let me close with this because, and this is the message today, you know, I did things a little differently. Let's get back to the what you have in your hand. Because not only does that determine what talents I have, that I need to take what I have right now, I have a small. I remember when we started out in the ministry, people actually mocked us. You know, I was 18 years old, meet my wife. When, you know, we get married. I was 19, she was 18. We get married, I'm 20, she's 19. People mocked us. They literally mocked us. And we just look at each other and go, you know, obviously they don't think we have anything, but you know what? We're not going to worry about that. We're just going to do what God's called us to do. And I can remember we were invited down to a town in the south coast of Natal, right after our honeymoon, because we went on honeymoon, we weren't preaching, you know. I mean, so stupid. I made it up to her now. You know, this year we celebrate 35 years. I'm going to take her to a desert island somewhere, you know, just remote place. And, but, I mean, so we go on honeymoon and we go preaching. So I've always said we're still on honeymoon, we're still preaching. Isn't that true, honey? Still on honeymoon? If we still are home, just stand quickly. Just quickly stand. And then just jump three times. One, two, three, like a quickly. One, two, three. Just as confirmation. No, because if she didn't do that, then you'd know I was lying. But that proved right there that I'm telling the truth. Amen. Hallelujah. And I know there's a lot of wives that would not do that for their husband. But I'm telling the truth. Okay, so when we started, so we go down, and the guy that invited us down, he left for America. So he said, look, I don't have any place for you to preach. Now, we've already come down there. We don't have a place to preach. We're sitting there. He gives us an apartment. We took some money, bought some food. So I knew we had food. Long we have food for the next 2 weeks is fine. So we're sitting there looking, and I'm looking at the ocean, thinking, what in the world are we going to do here? I mean, I didn't come here to sit in a, which the Lord was actually giving us another, like a honeymoon, a proper honeymoon, you know. But so we spent that whole week, and I went into the little town, and I went to the town hall that they had in the city, and I found out that they would rent the place to churches for 10 bucks a night. 10 bucks a night. I said, I want it for 4 nights, for next week, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. I went down, I found a little Indian print shop, and I printed 1,000 leaflets, and I left it open. Time, date, where, and we called ourselves, at that time we called ourselves Anointed Word Ministry, because we knew it was anointing in the Word, you know. So that was the name of it. So it said Anointed Word Ministry present, Ronnie O'Donnell, Count Brown, you know, the blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk kind of thing. And then you could fill in blank, time, date, and whatever. And so we wrote in the time, the town hall, the date and everything, and we went to the post box, and they put them in everybody's post box, and we handed out flyers and everything. And so the first night, I got my guitar there, you know, and everything, and I'm standing behind the curtain and looking. Adonic is just out there, and I had like a book table with one tape series, I think on the gifts of spirit, and a tape on righteousness, and then one on faith. That was it. Total series book table. And so I peep through there at 7 o'clock, and I'm looking, 2, 3, 4 people, and then I look, there's 12 people out there. So I'm sitting thinking, 12 people, wow, this is like phenomenal. Can we don't know who they are, you know? I mean, these people are just coming in out the woodwork. So I rejoice, because I heard of another great preacher that did the meeting, and the first night he had 2, and one of them was his wife. So I thought, I got 10 more than him. And I went out there and preached up a song. We led worship, you know, and she wouldn't say anything in those days. If I said, honey, come greet the people, she would look down, put her fringe over her eyes, and just shake her head. She would not say boo to a goose, nothing. She would say a lot to me privately, but nothing publicly. You know, that's why I knew God was going to use her, because I thought, boy, one of those days, the fire that you displayed towards me is going to be displayed out there, and the devil's going to be in trouble. So I knew God was going to use her. But I'd say, honey, come greet the people. No. So there was no, and I'd lead the worship, put it down, receive the offering, just keep it right there. There's nobody to go take it, count it, whatever. Just stick it on right where the podium is. And then when you call people out to pray for them, I had to catch them myself. There was no catchers. So come, put my hand on, Father, in the name of Jesus. I can remember splitting my pants right around. It was like I was wearing a kilt. The air was just, I thought, no one, the Scottish people love this, you know. So I had to take my coat off, wrap it around my waist and walk with the coat, because I didn't want to be arrested for indecent exposure. And so the crowd grew. We had about 33 people, you know, and on the third night. And then that night, a seasoned minister came, and he got up and made a derogatory comment. Not bad about us, but just said, you know, he's facing the sunset, and we're just kids and starting out. And the next night, that destroyed the crowd. So I've learned, don't let a person that's about to die get up and get the microphone. You know what I'm saying? Don't give a walking dead the microphone. You know, they'll kill the place. I mean, if I went there as a young person, I would encourage the people. This is just phenomenal, you know. But he got up and said, you know, I'm facing the sunset, and these people are facing the sunrise. They're still, you know, kids wet behind the ears. Yeah, basically. So boom goes our crowd. But we went straight from there, and we had enough petrol to get us about 2 hours south of there. And there was enough offering to take the rest of the handbills to rent that other auditorium for 4 nights to go in there and have some meetings. People came there. And then we went to another city where my mom and dad lived, and we rented the theater. And actual fact, I knew Kim Clement at the time, and he was into mainly music ministry at the time, you know. And I called him, and he came and did the worship for me. That was 1982. And in actual fact, he said that he knew the joy was real then because he ended up rolling and laughing behind because he said, I went out, there was like 20 people. And he said, Rodney went out there and acted like there was 10,000 people. And he was probably laughing at how ridiculous it looked, but he couldn't stop laughing. But I didn't treat it. There were 20 people. I thought it was like, this was huge. So when we go back to Johannesburg, people said, how was we? It's phenomenal. We were in this town. We were in that town. Well, how many people came? Well, we had 33 in this town. And what about? And people looked at us again. That's not ministry. And I looked at them and went, what? What are you talking about? We didn't know that we weren't being a success. We thought this was the greatest thing since sliced bread. We were happy. We were like pigs in mud. We were so excited. And they said, you're not going to go anywhere? I said, oh, we're going to travel the world. We're going to see stadiums filled. We're going to preach the gospel to the nations. And here we are, by the grace of God, 53 nations later, by the hand of God. If I had allowed them to intimidate us, we would still be back in Africa. Don't let anyone intimidate you about what you have in your hand. Don't let anyone mock your talent. Ignore what they say. And if they say anything about you, tell them, I don't care what you say. My pastor believes in me. He believes in me. He believes in my talent. And I'm going to take my talent and I'm going to multiply that talent. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's why I will never talk people out of anything God tells them to do. Ever. Ever. Never. You know, let me say this, and I'm closing really with this. If you keep discouraging people, if you keep discouraging them, you're going to discourage yourself. If you encourage others, you'll encourage yourself. Don't see people where they are now. See them where they're going to be. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And when I take the talent that I have, even though it might be small, a little becomes much when I put it in the master's hands because God takes it and he multiplies it. I can't imagine what's going to happen here in the next 3 years coming out of this teaching series on kingdom business. I can't even begin to comprehend for one moment what's going to take place. It's going to be huge. I said it's going to be huge. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I see real estate coming into your hands. I see businesses, restaurants, hotels, houses, condominiums coming into your hands, factories coming into your hands, property, land, acreage coming into your hands. Hallelujah. Houses, vehicles, transportation coming into your hands. Supernaturally. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Listen, if the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just, that means the devil's building you a house right now. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. The day will come when people will come just on the parking lot just to come look at the cars because of what God's doing. So great shall be the harvest and the blessing, but it'll not faze you one little bit. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. This is huge in the spirit right now. I can feel it, man. You feel it? I feel it right now. It's big. There are going to be people that have nothing right now. 3 years from now, you won't even imagine. You'll have to pinch yourself. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say this often, where I am now is not where I'm going to stay. But I'm going to multiply, increase, multiply for the kingdom of heaven. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I feel the anointing just being released right now. I feel the anointing just being released right now. Thank you, Lord Jesus. This is going to be a supernatural miracle that transpires this week for certain individuals that have been believing God, but you've reached an impasse, and it felt like you came to a place where you couldn't go any further. But thus saith the Lord, even this week it shall be removed out of the way. Every obstacle shall be removed, and between now and next Sunday, you rejoice, for the Lord would have brought you through. With a shout, he'll bring you out. I feel the gift of faith coming on people right now in this place. You know, I know this is a ridiculous analogy of what I'm about to give you right now, but it's like Popeye eating the spinach. That, you understand what I'm saying? It's like what I'm giving you is like Popeye eating the spinach. You know, because it's the word of God that comes on the inside of you. The word of God rises on the inside of you. I call the 3,000 seated dome set up. I call the dormitories that will house 500 students set up. I call every building paid. I call the annexing of other properties and lands in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You might say, why are you believing God 100 multimillionaires in the church? Because we need $100 million for what we need to do on this property. So I'm not waiting for them. You're going to come. They're sitting here in this place right now. And God's going to raise you up. God will raise you up for his glory. I'm not making this up. If you could go back with us 33 years ago and look where we were now and see what God's done now, then you'll see what God's going to do for you if you listen to him. If you obey him and serve him, you will spend your days in prosperity and your years in pleasures. And the blessing of the Lord makes one rich, and he adds no sorrow with it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Did you get something out of this here? How many grabbed this for yourself today? Sapra, it's like you're a magnet for the blessing of God. You know what a magnet does? You're a magnet for the blessing of God. You're a magnet for the favor of God. You're a magnet for the goodness of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. There's blessings on their way to your house right now while we speak. Hallelujah. There's Monday morning blessings. Monday afternoon, Monday evening blessings, Tuesday blessings, Wednesday blessings, Thursday blessings, Friday blessings, Saturday blessings, Sunday rejoicings. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Whew. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. There's so much more, but I can't carry on right now. Jesus. This thing is big. It's not about a Sunday message. This is about what's coming. This is about what God is positioning you to do. Hallelujah. At the end of the day, no one will be able to get the glory. Only God will get the glory for what God does. Only God will get the glory. And we'll never forget him. We'll only give him the glory. Listen, listen, listen. 2014 was one of the greatest years ever in the history of the ministry. 2015 topped that. 2016 is going to, this is already over the top. This year, I come back many nights to the hotel room crying my eyes out. I look at her. Can you believe what is happening? Can you believe what? Pinch me. Is this real right now? Because that's what God's doing. The greatest is upon us now. The greatest move of the Spirit of God is on us now. And we're going to see whole nations shaken. Hallelujah. Now, I'm not just saying it's like one out of the blue thing where I said to my wife, isn't this amazing? She'll tell you. It's on a regular basis. Can you believe this? And then I start weeping and saying, the Lord is so gracious to us to allow us to see this with our eyes. And to see what God's doing and see the harvest come in and see the souls being saved and lives touched. And the scary thing is that I could have got sidetracked 20 years ago and it could have, you know, got offended, been out of shape, I ain't doing that anymore. But we didn't. And now we're seeing the fruit. And it's big. It's huge. It's beyond anything you can imagine. Brother Rodney, I was saved in your meeting in 1995. I'm now pastor the biggest church in New Zealand. 10,000 member church. People I never even met. It's all coming up now. I came to the meeting, the fire of God fell on me. And I'm expecting to hear the testimonies that's going to come out of this church. I'm expecting. Testimonies like, I was in the inner city and I was on welfare and thought that there was no hope for me. My kids were all on drugs. And Jesus touched me and I grabbed a hold of the message. And now I've my own company. We've affected the whole of our inner city where I live. We're reaching out across America, other nations of the world. I mean, and I can go on and on because that's what God does when the anointing comes. Can you say amen? If this was about religion, we would have had our third service by now. It would have been 58 minutes long. Smoke would have been coming out of the platform. I wouldn't even be preaching or standing. I'd be sitting on a bar stool in my skinny jeans, sipping a soy latte with my nurse sitting on the front row next to my wife who had had so many facelifts. Just so you know, she's had nothing done. She is as she is. She's better now than when I married her. Fact. I tell her that all the time. Hallelujah. I'm probably not like I was when I married her, but she is. Amen. Hallelujah. The Lord's good to me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise God, praise God. Say, it's in my hands right now. Let's do this right now. Let's receive the morning offering, and then we're going to pray. I want the ushers to come, hand out the offering envelopes, make your checks out to the river. Do what God tells you to do. If you didn't come prepared, prepare yourself now. Online, watching, even on television, there's a PO box on the screen. Online, there's a drop-down box. Sow a seed, be part with us in the cities of America as we roll across this nation. This next month of May now is, of course, Dayton, Ohio, and then the Ministers' Conference. June, we're going to be in Uganda with the President of Uganda. And then July, we'll be in Baltimore. Landover, Maryland, right outside of Washington, D.C. Huge African-American church. It's going to be awesome. It's going to be Celebrate America Part 3. And right after that, we're going to be in Jacksonville, Florida. And then the summer camp meeting, August, we're going to be in Helsinki, Finland, and also in Kiev in the Ukraine, and also in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, Canada, and other places in America. September, we're going to be in Johannesburg, South Africa, huge 8,000-seated dome. We'll also be in Mozambique, 15,000-seated church in Maputo, and we'll be with the president of Mozambique. So we're starting, God's opened up 15 presidencies for us now to go to. And obviously next year we'll probably get to 6 of them. But we believe in God for supernatural things to take place in the nations. The first envelope, the handouts for your tithe and offering. The second one's for Jubilee, which is a 4-month pledge, believing God to pay off the property. And then the third one is for the building, for building funds, things that we use to, you know, keep everything like they should be. When things break down, you fix them. Amen. Palm trees dies, we put the new ones in. Parking lot looked bad, we redid the parking lot. The new classrooms over there, carpeted the sanctuary, new restrooms. Other things that need to be done around here. Can you say amen? Amen. Just so you know, we spend up to $7,000 every Sunday just on the buses that come in from the inner city. That's part of our outreach, the food ministry that we are now about to expand in the food ministry. I really want to get some freezers so we can get meats and things like that that we need. Amen. Hallelujah. You might be visiting here today. The Lord tell you to do something. You might be sitting here today. You've never done anything. Maybe it's time to do something you've never done before. Online, we'd love to hear from you. Be a part together with us. If you're watching on the Roku channel, just all new up for the first number of weeks now. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody say increase. Now, how many understand what you just did? By giving an offering, by taking an offering right now, what have you just done? I can't hear you. No, you've taken what's in your hand. You see, that's a talent that's going to be multiplied now. Amen. Through business is the number one way to get into China. Through business is the number one way to get into certain countries in the Middle East. We need businesses. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, I pray that you multiply the seed sown here today. Bless the gift and the giver. Meet every need of this people. Multiply them. Even this week, between now and next Sunday, let there be miracles. Extreme miracles. Over-the-top miracles. Signs and wonders in the area of provision. In Jesus' name, get them supernaturally out of debt. Every bill paid, out of debt. Debt elimination, mortgages paid, houses paid, cars paid, out of debt. In Jesus' name, those that need clothing, bless them with clothing, shoes. I thought the ladies would be happy. At least the ladies grab a hold of it. Shoes. Bless them, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. You ready to give?
Yes, sir.
Ushers, come. Go ahead and receive the offering. You know, talk about shoes. I've sewed shoes for years. Years. Blessed people with shoes. The last 4 weeks, every 2 days, shoes, pairs of shoes arrived for me. Go ahead, pass the buckets. That's what I said. You heard it right. Don't get stuck in a rut. The last, 4 weeks, every 2 days, shoes arrived for me. Coming out of the Carolinas, shoes. Nice shoes. Nice shoes. Very nice shoes. All kinds of colored shoes. Socks. I have so many pairs of socks, shoes, belts, shoes, nice shoes. Shoes that once when they were alive would bite you. Yeah. Nice shoes. Now, I know these people walk around trying not to, if you can, please. I understand if you desperately have to go to the restroom, that's fine, but try not to. I want you to bow your heads, if you would, please. What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? I believe one of the biggest concerns that I have concerning the message that we preach is that people would never get distracted and never turn their back on the Lord. And God knows, I pray that if that ever happens, that the Lord would just keep you and would never allow you to get blessed beyond what you could handle. Because I'm more interested in you making heaven than in you going to a lost eternity. Because your soul means more to me than any amount of money that you could make. We're not going to lose one person because of covetousness and greed. But the number one thing is the heart of man. And if you've come into this place this morning and you fit into any one of these three categories, I want to pray with you and for you. Maybe you walked in here today, you're not born again, don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Friend, I want to ask you a question. If you died today, where would you spend eternity? I want you to know there's a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. You don't have to go to a devil's hell, because 2,000 years ago on Calvary's cross, the price was paid and the blood was shed. And just like that old song said, there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all the guilty stain. Today, the power of sin will be broken. The power of guilt and shame will be removed from your life. And today you're going to walk out of this place changed, not by the hand of a man, but by the hand of the Lord. He loves you. Jesus is standing with arms right open. He says, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. I'm going to give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me. My yoke is easy, my burden is light. He calls you now. Will you surrender? You might never have another opportunity. This very day, your life could be required of you. By this time tomorrow, you could be in eternity. Will you surrender to him today? Will you say, Jesus, here I am. I give my heart to you. He loves you. Maybe you're in this place today, or you're watching by television, and once upon a time you gave your life to Jesus, but you've grown cold. You're not serving God like you should. You've allowed the things of the world to come in. You've lost your first love. You've lost the peace, the joy you once had. There was a time when you were radically on fire for God, but something happened. But today you say, I'm coming back. I'm a fall in love with Jesus all over again. Maybe it's something hidden that no one can see. Pride, unforgiveness, bitterness, jealousy, anger, lust, the hidden things of the heart. But you say, today I want to be free. He said, I will take out the stony heart and put in a heart of flesh. He said, a new spirit will I put within you. Will you surrender to him today? Will you say, Jesus, come and be my Lord and be my Savior? He loves you so much. He loves you so much. Maybe it's not hidden. Maybe it's outward. Other people can see it. The devil uses against you to keep in a place of guilt and condemnation. You feel like God can never use you because of things that have transpired in your life. I want you to know he's a liar. And God will take that which has been battered and bruised and torn by life and turn it around and give you a new start and a new beginning if you surrender to him today. Maybe it's not hidden or outward as we described. Maybe it's a storm that came against your life, a sudden divorce, a bankruptcy, the loss of a loved one, a sudden illness, the betrayal of a close friend, the loss of a job. Something happened that rocked your world. But today you say, I'm coming back. I want to be on fire for God. I want to be a radical believer. I don't want to be a wishy-washy Christian. I don't want to be a Sunday morning believer. I want to be a 24/7, 7 days a week, 52 weeks of the year, on fire. Somebody says it's not possible. It is. It is possible if you live in the fire of God. It's time to surrender. The temperature of your heart is either hot, lukewarm, or cold. He said, if you're lukewarm, I'll spew you out of my mouth. It's not the hour to be lukewarm. He loves you. And then lastly, you've come in this place. You do love the Lord, but the devil's always telling you that you're not saved. So there's that doubt, constant doubt. But today you want to know. You want to know that you know. You want to know that you know you're a child of God. You want that doubt to be removed. If this is you, if it is any one of these three categories, I'm going to pray for you now, right where you are. Put your hand up now and say, pray for me. I need Jesus. God bless you. 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 Raise up high. Raise up high. Let me see it quickly. God bless you. 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 God bless you, God bless you, God bless you, yes. God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. God bless you, yes, God bless you. Anybody else? God bless you. You can put your hands down now. I want you to look at me, please. Look at me, if you would, in this section here. If you didn't raise your hand, but you want to be included in the prayer, we're going to pray right now. Quickly, just slip up your hand, say, include me now. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Anybody else? Another hand? Anyone else? Anyone else? This section here, you didn't raise your hand, want to be included. Put your hand up. Thank you. Anybody else? Another hand at the back. Anybody else? Another hand over here. I was 5 years old when I went down. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else? Thank you. God bless you. Yes, yes. I want everyone that raised your hand to stand, please. Stand all across this room. Stand right now. Stand right now, everyone. Everyone that raised your hand, stand to your feet right now. Stand to your feet right now. Stand to your feet right now. We're going to pray. I want you to get out of your seat and come stand around the altar. Come. Come. Come now. We're going to pray. Come unto Jesus. Give him your life today. Just come now. Come now. Come now. Give him your life today. We'll sing that one more time. If there's anybody else that should have been down here, you didn't come for whatever reason, just quickly get up out of your seat and make your way down the aisle quickly. Before we pray. Give him your life today. Come unto Jesus. Let him have his way. Come unto Jesus. Give him your life today. Come unto Jesus. I want you to look at me right now. Today you did not come to man. I'm just a messenger. But today you've come to the Lord. And if you mean busy with God, God means busy with you. For over 36 years now, I've been doing this and watching calls just like this and then meeting people 10, 15, 20, 30, 35 years later, see what God's doing and has done with them. You might say, but you don't know what I've done or been. No, I have no clue what you've done or been. It's really none of my business. But I know what Jesus has done. And I know where he's been. And if you believe, you will receive. We can't earn this. There's no ways that you and I could ever earn salvation. We have to humble ourselves. We repent. We tell the Lord, I'm sorry. But repent doesn't mean, do we say sorry, we go right back. Repent means we actually turn from our sin and we leave it and we walk away from it. You know, that means I'm walking away. I'm out of this. And I know the enemy has hooks and there are many people sitting around you in the church today that were once bound by every kind of thing imaginable. Drugs, alcohol, everything imaginable, everything. And today they're totally free. So don't let anybody say, well, somebody say, can I be free from this? Yeah, Totally free. Delivered. Totally free. It's about surrender. So I want you to close your eyes and raise your right hand to heaven. That's where your help comes from. Pray this prayer after me. Believe it in your heart. Say with your mouth, say, Father, I come to you in the precious name of your Son, Jesus. Lord, you said in your word, if I confess with my mouth, Jesus is my Lord and my Savior, and I believe in my heart that God has raised you from the dead, I will be saved. So, Father, right now, I confess Jesus is my Lord and my Savior. Come into my heart right now. Take out the stony heart. Put in a heart of flesh. Wash me. Cleanse me. Change me. Fill me. Use me. Let me never be the same again. I turn my back on the world. I turn my back on sin. And I follow you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for dying for me. Thank you for shedding your blood for me. Thank you that on the third day you rose for me. And thank you that you're coming back again for me. From this day on, I'll never be the same again. I confess Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. He is my Lord and my Savior. And right now, by faith in the finished work of the cross and by the shed blood of Jesus, I'm born again. I am saved. Thank you, Lord, for saving me now. Now lift your hands and thank him right now. Just thank him right now.
If you prayed that prayer as I prayed with them, that means you accepted Jesus, your Lord and Savior. We want to hear from you. Go to our website at revival.com and you can email us a prayer request. Tell us that you watched the YouTube channel. We really love to interact with you and send you something that's going to help you in your walk with Christ. And then, of course, you can continue to watch every service is taken and uploaded. Either we live on YouTube or you can watch it on a rerun as we edit the messages down. And I pray that this YouTube channel's a special blessing to you. I'd love to hear from you. I want to interact with you. You can follow me on Facebook, on my Twitter account, my Periscope account, Instagram, whatever. All the links are found on revival.com, which is the best place to go. So let's just pray over you right now that the Lord would touch you and empower you and then become proactive in the kingdom. Let God use you in a powerful way to bring in the harvest of souls. And I pray for his anointing to touch you. Father, touch every one of our friends watching on YouTube. Raise them up to be mighty men and women of God and use them to impact their generation, we pray. Heal, restore, renew, revive them even now. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Thank you for watching. Keep watching and interact with us. We want to hear from you. We love you. If you'd like to be a part together with us, then support this ministry and sow a seed, revival.com. There's a drop-down box, online giving, or there's an address on the screen. You can send a love gift to our ministry, help be a part together with us in the Great Awakening as we travel across America and around the world, lighting fires. So we'd love to hear from you, and your financial support is greatly appreciated. From all of us here, we love you. Thank you for being a part.